For most of us in the data world, we assume that everybody understands the value of data and of analytics. And of course, people would want to invest in it. But the reality is, a lot of times that's just not the case. Sometimes you need to get buy-in from people in your organization or across your team to build something new, to implement a data architecture. So in this video, I want to share with you a few pieces of advice or just suggestions on things to focus on to help you get buy-in from others at your company or on your team, so that you can finally start building the things that you want to build and seeing the results that you know that would be helpful for your company. So the first thing I think we need to acknowledge is, even though we all, again, we see the value of data as engineers, the truth is we are a cost center for a company. So for those at the higher levels of the company that are responsible for budgeting and payments, we are not typically directly driving revenue. Those are typically the sales reps, the products, or whatever it is that's being created. And data teams and data architectures are expenses that support that. And a lot of times at face value, that's what people see. Now, of course, we know that you can use data to drive more revenue and things like that, which I'll talk about here in a second. But I do think it's still important to acknowledge that from a company perspective, we are typically an expense, a cost center for a company. The other part is, especially for smaller teams, but this is true for any company really, is the stakeholders, let's say the business stakeholders, are typically going to prefer quick workarounds than waiting for a data team to create a pipeline, to put it through the process to get them the result that they want. They want a quick answer and they just want it now. And they'll go around whatever needs to be just to get the answer so they can move on with their life. They're busy with other things. They got a lot of stuff going on. They don't want to have to wait for you. And that's really a cultural thing at the end of the day, I think, at a company, to respect the data team and respect what's going on. And I want to be clear that I'm not trying to say that these stakeholders in this case are bad people or they have bad intents. This is just the reality of the situation. I think a lot of people, they just are trying to do the best they can with what's in front of them. And sometimes it's just easier for them to do it that way. But until something better is in place that they can rely upon, that's trustworthy, this is just a situation that you're going to be dealing with. And I think we just need to accept reality of that's oftentimes what it is. So with that said, what do we do about that? What are some things you can focus on to still get buy-in in this type of environment? So number one, and this might seem really obvious, but focus on the benefits of data. When you're talking to people from the business and speak their language, speak the benefits that they would care about with data. So think about the questions that you get and why people are asking for certain things. Typically, from what I've seen, it's a few common trends. Number one, metrics. They want more metrics to evaluate their company. So focus on that. This architecture will give you more metrics, let's just say, or better metrics. Similar to that is, you could also say that this is going to provide a single source of truth for the company, rather than people from all over the company creating their own metrics and having their own versions of what they call the truth. You can present this as, we're establishing a single source of truth. So we all agree on the numbers. We don't have people arguing about what's right and what's wrong. And we can feel like as a company, we own that information. And of course, the idea of a single source of truth is a mythical thing. Let's be honest. There's always nuances that it's never 100% perfect, but it's usually pretty close and close enough to be effective. And really, at the end of the day, that's what we want. We're trying to drive decisions and help the company be more effective. That's the goal of data, typically, unless your product is data, which most of the time for us, we're internal data teams. We're not creating data tools that we're selling. We're supporting a business. So we're trying to make them more effective. And the third point here is similar to what I just mentioned, which is consistency. Rather than having people with conflicting numbers or things changing all the time because you don't have systems in place, you can have a consistent process to consistently deliver metrics and information that you can rely on. And it's just a part of the business that you can feel good about. And without a system and an architecture in place that you need to invest in, you can't have that. So those are some pretty good benefits that you can position it as. Of course, benefits are good to talk about, but something that's even better is talking about the outcome. What's the result of those benefits? It might sound a little weird, but it's not just the benefits that you're really selling in this case, you're selling the result of that benefit. So for example, as people from a data team, we are giving the outcome of better decisions. And by making better decisions with this data, you might make more money. So for example, when I worked for a logistics company and we were building reports and systems, we were able to provide data to help them evaluate routes and determine which routes were the most cost effective, which ones were we consistently losing money on with the trucking companies, things like that. So with more data, you can make better decisions and not overcommit yourself to losing bids in that case, and instead double down on ones that are more effective, and at least just give your sales reps the awareness of what the scenario is so they don't blindly go in and make poor decisions for the company. In a similar note, you could position that as hidden opportunities. Maybe it's not sales routes, but maybe it's, let's say, a marketing campaign that you now realize you can tie to specific sales, and that has actually been a really effective channel for you that you could double down on and do better for the company. So that is a hidden opportunity that without the right data in place to connect the dots, you didn't truly know the extent of the impact of, let's in that case say a marketing campaign, or could be anything, but it's those hidden opportunities that data is uncovering for you. It's really, that's insight. That's the insights that you're getting from data, but this isn't possible without investing and getting buy-in from the company on this stuff. And the last note I have on this is more awareness. And really, at the end of the day, this is control. So as a business owner and as business leaders, things can get crazy on a day-to-day basis. You're worried about so many different things. You're trying to keep things afloat. You're trying to monitor your team. You're doing all sorts of stuff. But having a sense of control is really valuable. So with data, you can say, I can present this information to you on a consistent basis in a way that is helpful for you, and you can feel like you're in control of your operations and of your business. Yes, it's a cost, but it's also giving you the control factor of your business, and you're going to feel like you're not going to be blindsided by certain things as long as we're working together to understand what the result is that we want and what you want to look at. So those are some things, again, to think about. So better decisions, hidden opportunities, and providing control. There's, of course, others, but those are ones that I found to be really good to focus on. Hey, real quick, I just want to hop in and say that if you're enjoying this video and you want some more content from me that's like this, I'll leave a link in the description and the first comment below that you can come get some more information, get some more content, and hopefully it'll continue to help you on your journey with data engineering for yourself, for your team, whatever it is you're trying to do. So again, there'll be some links down below, but with that said, let's get back to the video. So the last part here is, how do you actually do this? It sounds great in theory. What are some ways to tactically get buy-in and do these things that I just talked about? So number one, the biggest thing I think for technical people is we love to talk about technical stuff. And a lot of times that gets us into trouble. So I would say avoid technical jargon as much as you can. And this is not to imply that other people can't understand it. I think most people are intellectually capable of understanding what we're talking about. But the reality is a lot of times it's just not necessary to get into the weeds. You're going to get off the point. You instead want to focus on those benefits and those outcomes. And of course, at some level, you're going to have to talk about tool selection and costs and stuff. But the real technical stuff is better served for the data team to focus on, not for getting buy-in from a business on this stuff. So avoid the technical jargon. Next would be show versus tell. You can give a proof of concept for a very basic data stack that you want to implement, or just a report or whatever it is. Showing versus telling is going to get you a lot better results than just trying to talk about it. Because a lot of us, we're busy. Things are going on in life, with work, personal stuff. You can't expect to just give a pitch in a passing conversation or at the end of a meeting and expect somebody to just buy in to it completely. They have a lot more other stuff going on. But if you can instead already have something simple made, again, it doesn't have to be complicated, but just to give a taste for what's possible, it'll open people's eyes and they'll be more accepting to buying in on something like this, or at least taking that first step. So a great way to do this is to create, let's say, a playground data stack. Again, maybe it's not the final tools that you'll use, but it could just be an all open source stack, but just to show the concepts of, here's the idea that we're going for, and here's a way that we could potentially implement this in our own company. And then you can talk about future things that could happen and all the possibilities, and that'll get people excited. So adding on to that, the last piece of advice would be to get quick wins. The problem a lot of times with some of these data implementations and the kind of the reputation that this has is that it takes a long time, and it's a huge investment in the data migrations, all this stuff, it takes forever. And the reality is a lot of times that happens. Things can go wrong. Things can take longer than expected. And it's really hard to keep the momentum when things like that happen. So the goal, especially at the start, is to focus on quick wins. So here are some tips for how I typically try to make sure that happens. So number one is focusing on just a single deliverable. A lot of times what I see happen is teams will say, okay, we're ready to do a data architecture. Let's bring in all of our data sources and we'll just bring them all in here, and then we'll divide and conquer all of the data and create all these models together and try to get as much done as we can. And then the metric that's presented is number of tables built or something like that. And yeah, it might sound good, but really to me, that's trying to be busy but not productive, and it's not gonna move the needle. And from those on the outside, they just want to see those outcomes. So how can you get that quick? So focus on a single deliverable, just bring in the sources and build the models just for that deliverable before you move on. And then by doing that, you can create an end-to-end pipeline just on that deliverable and make sure it's solid. And with that in place, then your end users are happy because they're getting a result quickly. You're able to get it out the door faster, and it gives you time to work out the nuances of the data pipeline. So by the time you move on to the next one, you have some of those issues ironed out, and hopefully it'll be a lot smoother. You have some conventions established and you can gradually move your way through, because the goal here shouldn't be to rush. If you're rushing, things aren't going to end well. I see it time and time again, things are going to go wrong, but I also recognize that sometimes that's just part of the game. So it's a bit of a balancing act and dance. So how do you pick a deliverable? I would say focus on a current problem that somebody has. So maybe there's something that people wish that they could do right now, but they're not able to. You can come in as a team and say, hey, we'll build this pipeline for you first and foremost, and it'll get people fired up about it. Maybe there is an existing report that's all over the place you could rebuild, just a single report or dashboard. Maybe there's a data feed. Maybe there's something that's all in Excel now that you can migrate to a data platform, something like that. Just find something specific, focus on that, get it done, and you'll get a quick win and get momentum and better buy-in from the company than if you just tried to do everything at once, because it's just going to become a mess. And the last piece of advice I'll give on this is to try to avoid what I call shiny object syndrome. Maybe you've heard that term before, maybe you haven't. Basically, it's like when you're a kid and you see something shiny over here and you want to go grab it. And then you see something shiny over here and you want to grab that too. And you just want to keep adding on all these things because they're new and exciting and they're shiny. And unfortunately, even though that's exciting and it sounds cool in the moment, what unfortunately happens a lot of times is we think that we need all of these different tools because we read about it or we see other people talking about it, and we think we're behind if we don't have it in our team. What happens is you then make your data stack overly complicated way too soon. And on top of that, once you add something in, it's really hard to take it out. So the more shiny objects and the more components that you add, again, it's just so much harder to take things out than it is to add. So I always recommend starting with a very simple stack, simple conventions, keep it bare bones and simple and effective to start. Maximize those few tools that you have. Once you realize, okay, this is becoming too much and we're overcomplicating it by trying to keep it together, then look to add on a different tool to improve that particular process after you've proven to yourself that it's necessary for you. But just please remember that once you add it, it's going to be really difficult to undo it. So just be patient, don't rush into it, and avoid those shiny objects, especially at the start. All right, so hopefully you found all of that helpful. I know getting buy-in at a company is something that's really difficult, especially when you're dealing with different personalities and opinions on data and just investment in a company in general. But as always, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you at the next video.